Welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us tonight. It is with great pleasure I would like to introduce Ziad Jamaleddine. Ziad is a good friend, a great friend, and also a colleague from Columbia University. He is also a partner and owner of a company called L.E.FT, an architecture firm based in Beirut and in New York. And I have heard about L.E.FT before I started my own practice. It was in conversation, and I was very curious about the work that they do. It has always been a source of inspiration and also a role model for in our own development as an architect. So it's a great pleasure to have you here, Ziad, tonight to both share a little bit of background on the projects and your work, and also to celebrate the opening of the exhibition today. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for being here, and to start by thanking Ziad for the studio for having me here and hosting the visit and all the people that I have in the last few days. So tonight I'm going to have a short lecture, and it's really comprised of two compressed presentations. First I'm going to talk about our office practice a little bit, some of the work. I'm going to scan through some short effects. And then I'll talk about Amir Shakib Arslan Mosque, which is a mosque which I've just completed in a rural area in Lebanon. And through that, I'm going to try to talk about a little bit the research we've been conducting at our studio, but also at Columbia University in New York. So, it's going to be casual. So usually we try to start our lecture with this relatively old project of ours, which is really a bathroom renovation in an apartment in Lower East Side of Manhattan. And we start with that detail because we think that this project is emblematic or representative of the office approach, which is carried from the interior scale all the way to the urban and the architecture. So what you're looking at here is really the design of the glass door of the bathroom, which is designed in a way to hinge around the toilet paper. So you see the toilet paper intersects the pane of the door, kind of sticks to the outside. And it allows kind of ease of replacement of the toilet paper. Right? So if you're ever in the bathroom and run out of paper, somebody can basically save you their own bags by exchanging the toilet paper. So the solution starts from this, or the problem starts from this kind of pragmatic utilitarian need where to put the toilet paper in order to arrive to a new architectural solution. In this case, it's a mechanical tool that is the door, which allows us here to challenge basically that thin membrane that divides public and private in a domestic space. The first project I will talk about, it's called Duke House in Fakra, Lebanon, and it carries this idea of public-private again to the architectural scale. The project really sits on the corner side, kind of hugs the site, and it bends gently to create kind of a common area. But the main idea was that the client came to us asking for a space where they can host social events on kind of very frequent basis. On a rather really small site with not much space, basically to have a big venue. So we decided to use the roof as kind of the main public space or where the kind of social event would happen. And for that, we kind of created a loop which intertwined with the private part of the house without ever entering it. So one can arrive to the house, basically climb from the outside, go up to the roof, and then go back to the house without ever entering kind of the private area. So just kind of scan through some of those pictures. You can see here it's still under construction, almost finished actually. And then you see some of the circulation kind of thread that rushes in the interior without ever entering really the house itself. So I'm kind of having some model photos as well as the interior spaces of the house. Because it has this bent shape, we have the custom design. The dining table, so that it kind of fits in the space as well as the dining room fits in the space. It also allows a little bit of kind of conversation happening laterally as well as across the table. Alright, so And second house, again, deals with similar issue of public private. This is kind of a side research that we've been conducting at our office, which looks at the politicians' houses in Lebanon. Politician houses for the last maybe 30 or 40 years now, they've been taking over what's supposed to be the kind of public venue where the constituent can interact with their representative. So it's kind of like a town hall, but privatized. And it happens at the scale of the house, and it happens across the country, each religious sect having their own kind of house, the district kind of politician. These are some of the examples, historical examples, including the Pope, etc. And those houses are typically, they have this large room, but also they have smaller rooms, where you know you can have those backdoor deals can be struck and kind of politicking happening in the back areas, not in the front areas. So we were also approached to do a house for the population a few years ago. We kind of tried to kind of learn from that kind of vernacular political typology and level of political houses. And we created a house that has, instead of having a vertical separation, it has this 40 by 60 meter floor that separates the public areas below, which kind of aggregate of big spaces from the private centralized areas above. And the house becomes really kind of an aggregation of those massing on top and bottom, public versus private, which were then kind of challenged with these vertical spaces that cut across the verticality, this absolute horizontality. So again, a third project that was completed a few years ago and now is actually dismantled, which is the Beirut Exhibition Center located in downtown Beirut. So if you know the history of the region, you would know that actually Lebanon went through a civil war from the early 1970s until the 1990s, mostly in downtown area, which was mostly demolished, the rubble of which were kind of dumped into the sea to create this downtown area where the new city is supposed to be projected, supposed to be growing. And we were hired to design a site, an exhibition center, a pavilion, here on this exact site. But what the client saw as a kind of tabula rasa, a kind of ground, which is made out of sand, we saw it as a place where that really embodies the history of violence of the war, but also a kind of projection of what the city to come in the future. For that, we created a building that has basically a corrugated facade, aluminum facade, that would reflect the growth of the city around it. So the building becomes basically the indicator of the city that needs to be projected onto the site. So the more the building sits in this nothingness, it has a very fine kind of grain facade, but also very delicate given the construction site, the violent construction that would happen on that site in terms of producing dust and rubble, etc. But also, as the building, as the city grows around it, the building will be reflecting the identity, the continuously being shaped identity of the site. And you can see also like the effect of the collage technique of reflecting different buildings from different contexts and colliding them on the facade of the building. Basically, what happened is the building remained in this status. It never evolved because really the city around it was never built because of many political and social economic issues. And the building was eventually demolished without ever reflecting anything. A small gallery that we just finished in Beirut, which is off Hamra Street. Hamra Street is an interesting street that we've been kind of researching and documenting very quickly with some students at Columbia University. It's really a modernist street that is homegrown. It doesn't have this modernist building that you see in terms of the freestanding object of the plaza, etc. But actually, it's a series of rather generic office buildings and residential buildings facing north, this kind of experimentation with glass facade in the early 50s, late 60s. And on the west, on the south, with kind of deep balconies kind of breaking with the sun. But it's really a street that is kind of closely knitted with the fabric. And this is one of the drawings that the students have produced, kind of trying to basically excavate the history of those buildings and to understand the robust ground floor that it has in terms of stairways, shortcuts, small commercial units, etc. So you see, this is kind of one of the details, and most of those buildings have these internal streets that run across, across the sites. Nearby, we're working at the same time on this gallery, that is a gallery space that really sits in the basement. And one of the kind of early lessons that we learned is trying to really create a similar relationship from the one we were just discussing, which is trying to bring light deep down and trying to create a continuous circulation from the sidewalk all the way down to the gallery space. So the facade really is this slit, kind of opening, maximizing the openness to the sidewalk. And then as you basically descend down into the stair, of the main cascade of the stair into the gallery below, with the kind of views back into the sidewalk from the stair. The last project I talked about before talking about the mosque itself is a collaboration project we've been working on with Stephen Horn Architects in New York, which is in the Beirut Marina, located also in downtown Beirut, at this site. And the way Stephen conceived the project is that it's really a continuation of the cortex, which is this promenade by the water that becomes here public and kind of ramps up on the roof of the building. Just going to go through it very quickly. The building kind of expands the sidewalk to become this public platform with pools, reflecting ponds, as well as a seated area vegetation. And underneath it is kind of filled with commercial spaces. It's more kind of related to the water edge itself. All right, so next came the mosque, and as a research first, one of the first things that struck us was that Islam, as we understand it today, is perhaps one of the fastest growing religion in the world today. It's expected to be the biggest, basically, faith by 2025. And it's a religion, like we were discussing before, it's considered to be bottom heavy, meaning there are more youth than elderly people, especially when you compare it to Judaism or to Christianity. But what was interesting is that although Islamic population makeup was very young, there was a paradox, that is, we still build in those kind of historical or historicist terms when it comes to the architecture of the mosque. So a contemporary mosque today is really in this crisis mode where each community or each country is looking for what is authentic and what is the real mosque architecture supposed to be. Of course, the dome, the minaret, etc., these are kind of signifier of a mosque, but really the mosque is never really described in the Quran or in any religious text of what it's really supposed to be in terms of architecturally or even spatially. So there's really no reference, one reference to what the mosque should look like. Again, early in 2011, another event happened in Switzerland, which was the banning any minaret to happen in the whole country when mosques were built, which was kind of an early, if you wish, indication of Islamophobia that we see more of it today. At the same time, we were invited to this Prague Quadrennial of Performance and Design in 2011, for which we kind of adopted the Mosqueo del Mondo, Teatro del Mondo by Aldo Rossi, who he said that it's really the space of where the imagination, architectural imagination, starts. And it's a theater that basically travels in Venice in the water. And basically what we did is we kind of grafted onto the theater the only four minaret left in Switzerland, kind of as an act of defiance perhaps, but also we created this map, which is really the Mediterranean map, where this mosque, the Mondo now, will be traveling between East and West and negotiating and questioning this civilizational divide between modernity and what's supposed to be traditional Islam. So the carpet was actually like a praying area, which is a minimum mosque, it's all what you need basically to perform. And it was located at an angle within the exhibition space, facing Mecca. And actually now it's sitting in the exhibits here. The second kind of, or third round of research that we went through when looking at the typology or the architecture of the mosque was some of those design experimentation we had at architecture school at different times, Yale and recently more of it at Columbia University. And if you look at the translation of the mosque in Arabic, then you might know that as a Turkish audience here is that Jama and Masjid are both words that signify mosque. Of course, in Arabic, Jama means a place of gathering or of collections, where Masjid is really a place of prostration, where somebody could prostrate. And then the idea here that there is these two translations, and the student were focusing on the Jama as this expanded motion, which is a place of gathering that not only dedicated to religious functions only. So these are some of the visuals. I'm just going to go through really quickly of some of those ideas that the students were experimenting with. For instance, this one, kind of the student combined museum with the mosque, and that operates at different times, synchronized between the praying time and the opening and closing time of the museum. And she also worked on the skylight system that would also perform dual function, providing proper kind of sun, direct sun, east-west, based on the time of the day, but also on the sun needed, or on the light quality needed for the museum space itself. So finally, we arrive to the point where, you know, the existential question have to be here is, what is Islamic architecture, and if there is anything as such Islamic architecture, which kind of produces many other questions as problematic, perhaps. So when we ask what is Islamic architecture, are we also allowed to ask, for instance, what is Western architecture? And is therefore comparable to Christian or Buddhist architecture? So when we say Christian architecture, we're really talking about the architecture of the church, the church typology itself. When we talk about Islamic architecture, we're not only talking about the mosque, we're talking about any kind of architecture produced in the Islamic world across 4,400 years, across kind of a huge swath of geography, all the way from the east, far east to Mediterranean and further west. When did Islamic architecture start is really the question that every history of architecture poses, and that there is always the need to know when it did exactly start, like as if there is a creation point after which Islamic architecture started to be. Usually it's associated with the Prophet and the history of basically the early history of Islam. But really, is Islamic architecture born again with the Prophet at that very specific moment? Or where does it end? Also, history of architecture books usually tells us that Islamic architecture ends around the 18th century. There is no survey or studies or research that's done after the 18th or the early 19th century about Islamic architecture, which means Islamic architecture has always been understood through this lens of medievalization. It's always a medieval entity to research and look at. It never experienced, to say, modernity, so to speak. So Islamic architecture has to start and end. Is Islamic architecture only traditional? Yes, usually this is how it's being described. Or is it based on Islamic period? So when you find yourself, you know, faced with this huge body of work, we try to start to classify it, right? So is it first the Umayyad and the Abbasid and all the way to the Ottoman? That's one way of basically doing the discipline structure of Islamic architecture. Is it architecture in the land of Islam? This is perhaps the most logical solution that they arrived at, which is, okay, all the architecture that's happening in the Islamic world, let's call it Islamic architecture for now. Okay? Does it assume unity or diversity? More often than not, it looks or it seeks unity. Right? So whatever is happening in Anatolia or whatever is happening in Andalusia, there should be a relationship, and we always see them looking, seeking to find that idea of Islam being related to one entity or to one divine. Does it have any diversity? Of course it does, when you look at the architecture in India versus in Andalusia or in Morocco, there are differences. But then it's reframed that this is actually diversity within unity, or unity of diversity. So there's always kind of loopholes that we find historians trying to define Islamic architecture with. Is it universal? Of course every religion is universal. But the trick here is that if the religion is universal, is it practiced in a very universal way? Is it practiced in a similar way in different periods or in different regions? But this is very useful usually for architects today, because it is universal, then you can abstract it and you can appropriate it, right? So you know, Mushar Dabiya is the cliche example here. This is abstracted as being essentially Muslim or Arab. So it could be appropriated, it could be transformed, like the Institut du Monde Arabe by Jean Louvel in France, where it's becoming mechanized. It's a mechanized musharabiyya, so now it is modern. Before that, it was traditional. What is Islamic about Islamic architecture? I don't know. Nobody is able to answer that. Is Islamic art also secular architecture? Art or architecture is also secular? Is it to begin with the secular and the religious divide? Is it to begin with a Western paradigm that is imposed on Islamic architecture? So when you ask what is Islamic architecture, there's even more questions that are posed that are even more problematic, which really start to unravel the whole discipline as we understand it today. And this is where kind of the history became a little bit more rigorous in our studio and at school, as we kind of faced with the idea of designing a mosque soon after. One can trace some of those problems that we see today in the discipline to Fletcher, Bannister Fletcher, in the History of Architecture book, which is really a book done a long time ago, but now it's in its 21st, I think, edition. So it's being still published and used and taught at architectural school across Europe and the rest of the world. And what he was trying to do is to trace basically the evolution of architecture, right? So there's the trunk, there are all these different civilizations, but there are two kinds of branches. There are the L.E.F.T. branches, you know, Italian, French, German, and there are all these dead-end branches, right? You have the Byzantine architecture here, Mexican, and you have the Saracenic, which is really what we used to call Islamic architecture in the early 20th century. Sometimes that's called Mohammedan, sometimes called Moorish, Oriental, etc. So in a way, this, of course, this tree keeps on growing, and it ends here in the American. This is the flat iron building, in case you're wondering. But this is basically the logical progressive evolution of architecture, that some civilization and culture did not really flourish, and others did. So in a way, all those civilizations here were denied any notion of modernity. That's why when we talk about Islamic architecture, it ends in the 18th century, because modernity is something else, something new. It's something that the Arab Islamic world has never experienced, so we don't need to talk about it, because it really ended there. And this is, I think, an ultimate difference. Of course, the early Orientalist, like Jerome, the painter, visited the Middle East, Cairo, and other places, and they drew these fantastical paintings of what the Arab Islamic world is supposed to look like. Of course, they never sat really in the mosque, draw any of these figures, but they kind of walked through the city, went back to Paris to their own studio, and then they imagined, they kind of put together a new imaginary of what Islam or what the space of the mosque should look like. Of course, there are these ridiculous kind of naked figures here. There are these obsessively armed figure here, also very strange to that context around that time in Cairo. But then again, this is a construction of what Islam ought to look like at that time. The argument we're making here is this is not that different from what you see in this picture, which is kind of these new propaganda video kind of put out by ISIS that are very well staged, right? There is this mosque. This mosque is very much part of the picture or part of their argument. This is authentic, this neoclassical mosque. And also, is what Islam looked like for those people, right? They're also looking for what is authentic and what is unique about Islam. But then the next day they go ahead and they start destroying other mosques and shrines of other religious texts or of minor religious texts within the city. So this idea of, you know, the Orientalist imagining what Islam looked like as this unique moment in time, or ISIS imagining what Islam ought to look like today, trying to oppose it through force. But if we look at art, architecture, culture, cultural production, literature, because history, we always found negation and moment of paradoxes when you set out this argument to begin with. So this is really a prototypical Dutch neoclassical painting in the 1655. But if you look at it carefully, this is actually at the Metropolitan Museum in New York. You can see that there is this assimilation of what is considered Anatolia carpet at the time, used here as a painting block. So what is supposed to be a typical Western neoclassical painting is actually absorbing and assimilating Islamic visual culture. But you also see it in buildings like this one, which is often described by contemporary scholars on Islamic architecture as hard to classify. What is this? Is this Byzantine? Is it Romanesque? Is it Anatolia? It's really all of the above. You cannot really classify it in one category or the other. Even if you look at literature, produced even all the way up to the 19th century by this Italian poet Khaled, who described himself as a half-Muslim. He drinks, but he doesn't eat pork. So again, it's a kind of a joke. It's, you position yourself outside what you expect Muslim ought to behave like or ought to be. So we drew a map. We called it the Islamic City. And it's a collection of mosques across, there were 1,400 years across the geography, all the way starting from the Prophet's house here, all the way to contemporary mosques today in the Arab Gulf. But the project was set to fail from the beginning. It really was asking the question, can we unify the Islamic world in one drop? And the answer was no, because as you look through this timeline, the piece is exhibited in the back of this case here, you'll see that there is really no mosque typology. There's no one clan that you can say is the authentic or is the original one. But actually, there's a hybrid. It's always a hybrid typology that keeps on evolving and adapting to its own context, its own culture, its own politics and economy, etc. But there are traces and there are things to learn from the maps. So as we started kind of trying to draw it, you know, we found characteristics that could be perhaps highlighted. Like the early mosque was really integrated in the city. It wasn't only integrated in the physical fabric itself, but it was also integrated in the society it was supposed to serve. It was built by the people who ended up using it, but it's also it's in the proximity to where they lived and where they worked. So the Umayyad mosque, for instance, in Damascus, the Grand Mosque of Damascus, really sits on the church, which really sits on the temple, the Roman temple before it. So it's really what you consider today as one of the most important Islamic architectural mosque or typology is really an amalgamation of all these civilization before it. But it also integrated itself into the market, right? And this is one of the characteristics that we know of today. But then there's the courtyard, which kind of cleared the way and it's introducing the sacred. Another interesting mosque that we kind of looked into, which is Al-Karawi Mosque in Fez. And it's really a university. It's one of the oldest universities still operating today. Ibn Khaldun kind of graduated from it. But you see also the mosque, how it kept on kind of growing within the fabric, and it was tentacles expanding and occupying those pockets with different schools and different classrooms. As we keep going, this is familiar for you, this is Sulaymaniyya, and this is Husn al-Basha Mosque. Not unlike the Umayyad Mosque, here the separation between the market and the sacred space, the religious space itself, is happening in sections, this upper balcony that kind of separated itself from the bustling market below, but it's really still part of the city itself. But we also tried to expand the field to include mosques that were never really in the picture. So this is Aga Huzur Mosque in Iran, which really sits on a water system that is kind of integrated in the city, and the building is no less than a piece of architecture that kind of belongs to that water system to begin with. We also included an agricultural mosque. There's always the emphasis on looking on urban mosque. Islam is always described as an urban religion for some reason, which means that for the best part of the 20th and 19th century, nobody was looking at agricultural mosques or at rural areas of the Islamic world to study them to begin with. So that kind of part of the history is kind of all absent at this point. So we try to expand some of those. This is, for instance, Hassan Fathi Mosque in New Gurna, which also sits in this agricultural field. The whole town was built around agriculture as the industry of this. Of that community. And then as we come closer to the modern period, we start seeing, of course, the infrastructure, the highway, we start seeing the modern zoning happening in the setback. And we start also seeing that the mosque becoming larger in scale, if you notice, but also becoming isolated, right? And people living here, they have to drive to reach to this mosque. This is Ulvi Khan, Bangladesh National Assembly in Dhaka. This part of the National Assembly is actually a mosque, and it's really part of that monument. This is the National Mosque in Malaysia as well. This is the mosque in Baghdad by Walter Gropius. This is another period that's totally missing from the history of architecture, which is the modern period in the Arab and Islamic world. The map really tried to erase the elevation. It's really looking at the map, at the plan, and to study the plan, trying to shed away any kind of bias towards aesthetic or towards understanding the mosque from a stylistic perspective and really focusing on the way it sits in the context and the way it's organized spatially. But again, you would see smaller mosques. You see this one, Sharif al-Din White Mosque in Bosnia, which is really one of the most interesting modernist mosques in the 1980s. And here I made an exception, I just put a picture of it because it's so small to notice, but it is often compared to modernist architecture in Europe, but actually it was really a building that is sitting in the backyard of this community, serving that community. And then there are these grand moments where you see King Khaled Mosque international airport in Iran, where the mosque really, not unlike the water, kind of water tank reservoir infrastructure mosque, this one trying to link to an airport, it's really sitting in between the runways and connected to those terminals. And this is the other terminal on this end, the Royal Terminal. But this is, I think, it perhaps is an interesting moment, also never looked at in the history of architecture. I couldn't find any reference. We had to kind of make up the plan by looking at the aerial view and sending somebody to take pictures on the inside. It's never really documented or analyzed, but this is an interesting moment where the architecture is actually trying to belong to this kind of global network of movement, of travel, And it is a piece of infrastructure as much as the terminal itself. And then, of course, we end up in those grand mosques, like Sheikh Zayed Mosque in Abu Dhabi, which really, its context is beautiful, supposed to be kind of Islamic landscape that can only be seen from the sky. And also it sits, of course, in the sea of parking lots, not like anymore, you know, with these huge drop-off area, and the mihrab becoming here almost a space by itself, which is kind of the VIP part of the mosque, which is inside, behind the space of the mosque itself. So that map we've been working on and populating, and it's really, it's exhausted, but it's in no way complete. We first exhibited it at Oslo Biennale this past summer, Architectural Biennale, as this long table, low table, that people has to basically squat to basically look and on those carpets, basically to be able to see more carefully. And then in it were kind of also built in a call to prayer that's also going to be playing here in the exhibit, which was designed by Baram Samarkandan, which is also a reinterpretation of what the call to prayer should look like or should feel like today. So unlike the table here in the, at Studio-X, we went for the kind of more diorama effect. The curtain wraps around the space all by itself. On the floor, you can kind of follow through and see the different mosque typology kind of titled based on the theme that we kind of extracted from them. So this is on the interior, and then on the exterior, we created another timeline here. It's a timeline what we call that this is really the construction of Islam and the construction of mosque architecture. The outside is the destruction of that same timeline, except that we focus mostly on the 20th century. And this is to say that, yes, you can look at those monuments and deduce what Islamic architecture is, but maybe there's another history to be written when you look at what has been destroyed and demolished, as opposed to what has been built and made as monument of states or of patrons or of sultans, etc. So I just took a few, slides just to give you a sense of what happened. We hear about ISIS and what they're doing today, which is obviously horrible and disgusting. But in the early 30s, you see, for instance, in the USSR, Stalin's atheist five-year plan, which is really trying to kind of secularize the whole country by destroying or transforming 25,000 mosques. That's kind of in one and five-year plan. But then there's a turning point. There's in 1979, in KSA, there was a siege of Mecca by extremist insurgents who were trying to basically destroy Mecca itself. And then there's really 1979, if you look more carefully at the political history of that region, is really a turning point from what happened before to what happened after. In 1979, there was the first war in Afghanistan against the USSR, by, you know, backed up by the United States in order to fight communism. And there was the resurgence of kind of Sunni extremists at this point, Taliban included. But also in 1979, there was the Iranian Revolution, in case you're wondering what else happened, which brought to the fore here the kind of Shia extremists. So it was a turning point in history, late 1970s, beginning 1980s, where you start seeing this kind of this extremist Islamic political movement emerge, which is really, in fact, and all I'm trying to say here is that all these movements are contemporary and modern, and they're not historical as we've been kind of taught and kind of learned to understand them as being old history of violence continuing in the region. Of course, you know, by 2015, ISIS is the biggest kind of news with all the kind of erasure of history and archaeology in Syria and Iraq. But when you question the universal aspect of the mosque architecture, you also have to question the universal man, which is really here represented by Corbusier Modular. That's supposed to be the humanist interpretation of what man should look like, the proportion, the positions. And we've been playing with the Corbusier figure for a while in our office. Earlier, it was militarized as we looked at the Middle East in terms of history of war and conflict and perhaps resistance. Later, it became a drunk when we looked at some of the competition we worked on, like the PS1 competition in New York, which was kind of a party space. But here, today, we're looking at the Corbusier, you know, modular expanded to include positions that really these do not fully cover or document. So here we kind of documented the position of any person, standing, sitting, etc., who wants to shoot. You can see it here on your left, kind of there is a man and a woman version of that modular. And the exhibit becomes really structured around these two pieces, the map, the modular reinterpretation, and the first piece being documenting the architecture of the Amir Shahid Aslam, which we'll talk about in a minute. So during all of this kind of research driven by design, important to note here that we were not historians, we were architecture designers, we were architects, and we used the drawing techniques and representation technique as a mode of understanding that history and representing it and at this point, and at the same time being critical of it. But at the same time, we were invited to do a to design a mosque in kind of quaint town of Andutara in the rural area, Shouf Mountain in Lebanon, located really at this intersection here, at this very corner, which is an 18th century structure that connected this 18th century old palace, which was the kind of the client residence. You're coming from Beirut, you kind of pass by through several towns and really continue up to the mountain, and here you keep going up to another location, the cedar kind of forest. This is the site as we were handed to us. This is kind of the old structure, was added in the 70s, this building which we first destroyed. And the interior was really 120, 150 square meter space that's supposed to be transformed into a masjid. But from the beginning we were not sure what the mosque would look like. So we were obsessed with this idea of a ghosted mosque or maybe a silhouette of mosque that exists and does not exist. For one, the orientation doesn't work with Mecca, so we have to kind of rotate the building to face the proper direction. And then we start experimenting with this idea of ghosting or shedding the mosque, that the silhouette of the mosque transforms as you walk and move around it. So at a certain point, it's a building that's kind of recognizable with the minaret and kind of inverted dome here, which I'll talk about in a minute. But at the same time, as you rotate and you move around it, the structure becomes very transparent and kind of blends itself with the kind of this very rich backdrop. But also at night, it's kind of partially lit, partially kind of not lit, so that it appears and disappears as well. And it was generated by this idea of kind of shredding, right, directionality versus Mecca. All these kind of steel elements kind of faithfully parallel to Mecca, which you see here in the space of the museum. We kind of also trace that direction in the physical space itself. And then we were playing with this idea of the model. You know, whether it was, is this the shadow or is this the real element kind of second element that was added onto the mosque? But it was a mosque that's supposed to be kind of the anti-thesis mosque of what we know of Shamsi Basha, for instance, Arab mosque here, which is Urduga. Which is really a cube that is contained in by itself, it's introverted, it's looking inward. And what we were interested at actually to rewrite that language by introducing those extroverted curves, concave and convex, that helped us first define kind of the main public space, which is this plaza, the civic plaza that we added in front of the mosque, but also helped us kind of shape those different sub-spaces, the roof garden that we opened, that's also accessed from the side here. And it created all these, this is what we call a rotated axonometric view, which is kind of taking the model and looking at its spatial potential at each and every moment, whether it was from the inside or from the outside or tangential to it. And you would see, for instance, the different spaces that the structure envelope here try to frame or define in and around the mosque as you walk around it, climb to the roof and to the roof garden itself. We were also reading many theologians that kind of worked on critically understanding the history of Islam, like Yusuf Siddiq and Muhammad Arkun. Muhammad Arkun is a very interesting figure who really kind of wrote the history of Islam from a humanistic point of view, looking at the humanism as in the tradition itself. Yusuf Siddiq, who is a Tunisian, who's still alive, talked about something very important. We talked about the word Iqra, which means read, which is the first word supposedly that came to the Prophet that asked him to read the Quran. And he's saying, okay, God asked us to Iqra, to read, he didn't ask us to recite. So there must be a difference there. Reading is not reciting. So to read the Quran is to be actually critical of it and to think about it with your mental critical faculty and perhaps to interpret it, right? So it's not a meta text. It's not a text that is given to us that we cannot question or interpret. What reciting is really about mimicking and basically saying the words without thinking about them. Which kind of came into play in the interior of the mosque itself, which I will show in a second. This is a book by Hamad Al-Khun on Al-Insana wa Al-Islam, about humanism and Islam. And then, giving the kind of very frail structure that we came up with that would work with this idea of ghosted, solid, transparent envelope, we needed more kind of structural support. And then here, we started to mobilize kind of a new idea of calligraphy as a structure, perhaps. So we incorporated the word insan, human being, on the ground plane, and of course there is the word Allah on the minaret that was we were asked to begin with to kind of have it as part of the architecture. But what's interesting for us is that the construction of the drawings here becomes the structural drawing, right? So you don't know where the calligraphy starts and the structure ends, so to speak. Of course, this is not new. It has many precedent in terms of incorporating text within the Islamic art itself. And also, the early traveler to the Middle East, the Orientals especially, were looking at the Islamic world and the Islamic architecture. And they were finding it very offensive because it doesn't have the purity of form versus structure versus ornament. It was kind of all amalgamated together, and hence it was disregarded as being worth kind of study. So this structure was prefabricated and installed in place, and suddenly you see the emergence of the text here. If you read Arabic, you can see it pretty clearly. These are some of the early studies. The word Allah here is actually made out of this bifolded plate. So when you look at it from one side, you would see it written as a void, kind of a moment of doubt. You don't know if it really is there or not. And then when you look at it straight ahead, it's more a positive plate that kind of forms the word itself. Kind of some of the details of the minaret. And the way the steel plate is bifolded, or the kind of structure itself, brace itself, but at the same time create the text and the calligraphy. So rendering. And it was really a rural mosque. And the president for us was another rural area not far from where we are, a smaller town across, leading to Mukhtara. And it's not like any town, there's nothing special here. There's a church, there's a mosque, there's in our town here, there are two kind of churches, and this is really not unusual, as you guys know, in this part of the world. But what's nice about the Amar town that we studied is that it has also a little fountain here. It has a statue, we had a statue kind of celebrating an important figure in the history of the region. But it also had this really small pond or fountain next to the mosque being used for ablution, but it really becomes like a pit stop along the way where people refill their kind of bottled water and and rest in this plaza. In a similar way, our mosque was attached to this 18th century palace that literally sits on a canal, on a spring that runs through it. And like all traditional vernacular architecture in that region, like the baths here in Istanbul, the palace which is here sits on this spring and it's used for all kinds of purposes, right? It's used for agriculture, it's used kind of to be heated, and then it runs into the wall of the bath kind of to heat the room. It's used to grind food. Historically, it's used as a very noisy fountain in the middle of the palace, so that if you're talking, there's a sense of privacy around you, nobody can hear you if you're having a private conversation. And then it continues and it runs into the town below. So our mosque was really kind of attached to the system, so what we did is we took this naturally kind of running spring connected to this fountain that we revived that was there sitting on site, and then which was also connected to the ablution area. It's all the continuously running water and goes back and join kind of deliver the spring itself. So the first thing we did was to kind of revive the school that's now active, and then the water runs into the kind of the ablution area, which always a running water, which kind of became instantly also another stop on this kind of traveling route. it sits at this high altitude of the mountain. There is kind of a generation of bird flocks through here in the region at different times. So we were hoping that also the project with pine will have kind of an ivy growing on it, and it becomes also perhaps a stop or a refuge for kind of birds that we kind of studied, and we looked into perhaps having the opportunity to house them within the structure itself. The interior is really simple. It's kind of white out stucco that's imported from Aleppo, which is kind of available in the region. And then the mihrab is really the only fixed point, which is really give you the direction to Mecca. And here it's done in reflective aluminum, which is, if it is a fixed point, it's also a fixed point that needs to be questioned. So I didn't talk about that earlier, but the history of Islam, even the direction to Mecca was only defined later. So at a certain point, the Prophet's house was facing Al-Qudus, the Dome of the Rock, and then the Umayyad, when they built the Dome of the Rock, was actually in competition to the rulers in Mecca itself. So even this directionality to Mecca that we take for granted was actually negotiated through time and then became what we know of it today. But that kind of became an opportunity for us to also talk about that very specific historical moment. The carpet here was designed also in collaboration with the Lebanese artist Laurence Abu Hamdan, which is really a visualization of Quranic verses. And it kind of gives you this blurred ground, kind of unstable ground. The pattern is printed on it, so with time it will wear out and it will show kind of the use and abuse of the space itself. There's a kind of skyline that is cut also facing Mecca, and that kind of brings through which you can look back at the minaret. I don't have a picture of that here. And then the back wall, which is a small kind of reading area with the word Iqra that we kind of talked about earlier, inscribed in the wooden pattern. This will be soon kind of a small shelf for books. And this is kind of the visual relationship between the interior of the mosque and the top of the minaret. The minaret is usually this urban symbol, and here this kind of interiorized and comes back into the space of the mosque itself. When the mosque opened, I think it performed in the way we hoped it would, which kind of spilled all the way outside to the plaza with these kind of carpets spread everywhere. And then Who Builds Your Mosque is kind of a spin on Who Builds Your Architecture, which is a research conducted partially at Columbia University, looking at who builds what for us today, especially when you talk about regions like the Gulf, with this huge kind of project built by kind of cheap labor. But here, Who Builds the Mosque was kind of a series of people that really came together. Although we hoped for and we aimed for it, it wasn't that hard to achieve, that all these people come from different religious sects, from different parts of Lebanon, you know, the welder, the surveyor, this is kind of the local Druze guy, these are kind of Christian from the north. Anyway, this is not really important, and it's not even an important story to say, except to say that this is what happens when you build in that part of the world, and this is what has happened historically when you look at the architecture of the mosque, is that, for instance, Cordoba Mosque in Andalusia was built by Jewish and Christian experts at the construction industry when Islam came and invaded and became kind of the rule of the land. In the same way, when it shifts hand to and Andalusia became Christian, they used local Muslim experts kind of to maintain and to upgrade the mosque itself. So this is nothing really new and nothing really strange to talk about. But unfortunately today, I think it's something to highlight, just to say that there's really no, that our entire history needs to be rewritten. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. I think we will skip a formal Q&A, what do you say? And we will do, since you are here, and we will have monthly food upstairs and this exhibition to look at downstairs, please join us to celebrate. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And please, any questions, I think Ziad would be happy to answer, so please don't be shy. Okay, thank you for coming.